said church was a thing of the past. It had no place in the future, and we should move on. They told us we had no money and no experience. But Jesus said that he would build his church. So we decided to listen to him instead of them. So we've seen Jesus do so much more than we could have ever asked for or imagined. When the church is working, people have hope. Lost people are found. And entire communities are changed. It's time for the sleeping giant known as the church to rise up and be who Jesus called us to be.
I gotta just say, that video really does choke me up. It's very emotional to me because that was 5 years of, you know, very hard work.
Very hard work. Yeah. Now it's so easy. It's a breeze.
Good morning. How are y'all this morning? Y'all doing all right? Good.
This is my wife, Natalie, in case you guys don't know. For those of you who are visiting with us, my name's Marcus. I'm the lead pastor here at Crossroads Church. It's good to have Pastor Joel back in town as well. So he'll be beginning a series in a couple of weeks. Actually, we're going to start one next week on the power of your words. So you don't want to miss that. It's going to be a great February series. But this morning, if you have your notes, you can take them. If you have your app, you can. The notes are going to be in there. And also, just want to remind you, we've got connect groups that are going to go on, grow groups that are going on. And so you look through this menu, and you can see the opportunities that are going to be available to you this particular semester in the spring. Two of the ones that we want to highlight real quick is Rachel's right here, and she's doing a yoga class on Tuesdays. Okay? So, guys, y'all want to go to that class and make sure that... No, it's girls. Oh, it's girls only, I'll say. Sorry. And then the other one we have for us, guys, or this is a family thing, but it's CMA, Christian Motorcycle Association. And so, yeah, so Jeremy, I don't know if he's here or not, but basically it's that one on the very far end. But every month it's a motorcycle association. We're going to become a chapter of the Christian Motorcycle Association here in the next few months. That's our goal anyways. So this is for men and women. You're more than welcome to be a part of that.
And I think we need at least 10 or more members to actually be a full chapter.
To make that work. So I think it's awesome. This will be a great opportunity, guys, for you to make an excuse to buy you a motorcycle, okay? A trike. So, hey, listen, we are going to share some things in our heart before you guys this morning. I'm going to tell you some stories about how we started this church and some of the things like that, cast some vision, help you understand where we're going in 2021 and your part to play, our part to play. So this is not going to be a regular morning, you know, message, so to speak, but we felt like once a year we need to get together. I feel like I'm 3 weeks behind because, you know, we wound up in bed for about 14 days or so. Not in bed, but, you know, at home.
We were laying down.
We were in bed for a while.
Yes,
and she is.
What
are we engaged? And she is pregnant. And so, anyways, I feel like I'm a little behind, but here we are, where we're at right now. Now, I don't know about you, but I love the local church.
Yep.
I love the local church. I love this local church. I love what we're doing as a family and the community. But I do not like the situation that we are in, and we find ourselves in, when it comes to the, you know, the culture, the environment, the pandemic, all that craziness, right? You know, I know that it's hard for me to navigate through some of these things, but as I go, the Lord shows me some things and I'm doing the best that I can with what I have. Sometimes you're wondering, is it, you know, is this the right thing to do? Is this the right thing to open up? Should we shut it down? And so you're going through all those emotions, so it's difficult sometimes. And I know for you, you're probably going through similar emotions like, hey, should I go or should I not go? You know, I heard so-and-so got COVID and they're at the church, should I not go? And we'll just call everybody so that they don't come. No, you can't do that, okay? But we know that some of you guys are online and you're wondering, should I ever go or should I go back? Some of them haven't come back. And so it's really frustrating as a pastor. In other words, how we do church and how we've done it for the last 14 years or so is not how it's being done right now. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
It's a little bit different. And guess what? It's probably going to be different this year. But we're okay with that because God's going to show us. He's going to help us how to be the most effective with the tools and the resources that he's given to us. Woo. And lives are still going to be transformed.
Amen.
And still be changed. Amen?
Well, the vision remains the same.
And
just because things happen, you can't get off course.
That's right.
You cannot let things that are on the outside dictate what God wants to do with you on the inside. Amen. And so one of the things that we're going to be sharing today is just the vision of Crossroads Church. Why are we even here? You know, why did we start? And like we said, we're not going to let the things from the outside detour what God wants to do for this city, for this body, for you and your family today in this moment.
You know, we have a saying here at Crossroads that says, you never let what's wrong in your life keep you from worshiping what's right about God. Amen. So we're just going to, you know, press into the things of God, press into the mission that he's called us to do, and we're going to keep moving forward in his name, proclaiming his name to all people. Amen.
Amen.
So there's a great example of that this past week. So some of you guys don't even know this, but, you know, we have a security system, in case you guys want to break in. We have a security system all the way around here. And it just so happened that one night last week, I went outside and I just said, you know what? I need to look at the security system. And I looked at the security system and immediately I saw a shadow around the building. And so I began to trace the shadow, and it was a guy that was, it looked like as he was trying to break into the church. And so I called our security guy and I said, hey, call the sheriff. Somebody's trying to break in. I'm taking off. And so I met them over here. Long story short, for the next 2 days, this gentleman, we found out who he was. And 2 days after that, we had our security guy in the office, in here in the living room, and he was on his phone. I was like, what are you doing? He goes, I'm looking at the guy walking around. I said, what guy? I said, the same guy. He's like, really? He says, he's like here on property. He goes, he's on the property. I said, well, let's go outside and talk to him and find out what's going on. And so he was like, you sure? We shouldn't do that, probably. And so we went ahead and did it. Long story short, the same guy, listen, the love of Jesus breaks the hardest of hearts. And so we led him to Christ right there on the bridge. That Wednesday night, he comes to the Lord. I mean, he comes to the service that Wednesday night. We're doing a prayer and worship service. And I'm telling you, this man drops to his knees as we're worshiping, as we're praying, and repents of his sin. And God supernaturally does something in his life. And here's what I'm telling you. Now, I'm saying all that to say this, is that I don't care what kind of pandemic's around here, the gospel of Jesus Christ is still power. Yes. It's the power of God unto salvation. Amen? And so we'll never back down from that. And whoever and however God opens the doors for us to communicate that's what we're all about. And you are a part of that. Amen?
Amen.
And so some of you guys, I see some of you guys are coming back. And I love that about you. Some of you guys are online and you haven't made it to come back. And some of you should be back. There are others of you that should stay at home. But you have to deal with that. And I have to keep my heart right, right?
Yes.
And so we move forward all as a team. Now, there's a scripture in Proverbs that I really, really, in Psalms that I really love. It says, those that are planted in the house of the Lord will flourish in the courts of our God. In other words, you find yourself rooted and established and in a place where you plant yourself, man, you know, it's a good place for you and your family. It's a good place to root yourself. Natalie and I, everything that we have experienced in our life, the success and the hurts also, but where we're at today as a family, the reason why it's directly connected to the local church that we were a part of. Mm-hmm. This is only our fourth church that we've ever been a part of. We first got saved, we became a part of a church called Gospel Lighthouse, which is over there off of Tour Drive. Then we went to, the Lord led us out of that place after a couple of years because we moved to another city and we were part of that ministry for the next 20 plus years. And the third church was when we went to Bible school in Oklahoma, Broken Arrow, Oklahoma. We were a part of the church that the ministry was a part of, which was like a 4,000 or 5,000 member church over there. And in every single one of those churches that we were connected to, man, the Lord instilled certain things and deposited certain things in our lives for our walk with Jesus individually and as a family. And also the giftings came alive because we began to get involved with the opportunities that were there before us in that local setting. And man, I'm telling you, when you plant yourself in the house of the Lord, you will be blessed. Now, the reason why the motivation for being in the house of the Lord is not to be blessed. The motivation is to be obedient to what the Jesus said in Hebrews, or what the Lord said through Paul. Don't neglect the meeting together, as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near, right? Mm-hmm. So the motivation for being a part of a local body is never so that you can get something. It's so that you can obey the Spirit of God, obey the Word of God, and in doing that, through your obedience, blessing does come.
Amen, amen.
Amen. Growth does come.
Yes, it does.
Are you out there? One person clapped. All right, good.
Well, I have to say this about that. If you notice on both of the scriptures and in any part of the scriptures when God's speaking to you, that there's always a part that we play. Those who are planted in the house of the Lord, that's our part. We plant ourselves in the house of the Lord. What's the promise that comes from that? You will flourish in God. Mm-hmm. And I love that about everything in God's word. There's a part that we play. It says, let us not neglect. Who? Let us. That's our part, as so many people do. But why do we not do that? It's so that we can, why do we not neglect that? It's so that we can be here to encourage one another in the Lord, right?
Amen.
So I love how God's promises always come with our part. He just doesn't put his word out there so that you can't find your way through it. But one of the things of why we wanted to share this morning as well, and we're going to tie a bow and make this nice and neat. We might just be throwing some things out there because we have limited time. But one of the things that we want to talk about is vision. The whole reason that Crossroads Church exists today is because God gave us a vision to be here when we knew a long time ago in 1991, Seguin, Texas was not in our heart, but it was in the heart of God. And so God, it's not any mistake that you're here today from something that God had put in our hearts long time ago in 1991 when we were in Bible school. Pastor Marcus shared about us being in that one church in Oklahoma. That's where we were. And so
that's where it all started there.
Yeah, Crossroads Church is here because of a 1991
experience.
Vision that God put in.
Some of you guys heard about that vision, but here's why we're passionate about what we're going to say here. Is because we understand now when we were walking through this, we didn't realize it. But now looking back, it makes sense. Yeah. And so all of a sudden we realize the importance of the local body and how vital it is to be involved. I'm not saying that so that you can stay here in this church. But I am saying that you're here in this church for a reason at this time in this season of your life. So you have to evaluate and look at that, okay? And find out what you're going to do with that because you have a part to play. Many of us are just walking in a small percentage of the gifting that God has given to us. And if we lean into that and overcome the fears that come with being a part of a local body, man, I'm telling you, if you will see yourself and your family in places that you've never thought you'd ever be. You know the plethora of the body of Christ in this community. It's so diversified, but it's so beautiful. That's what makes it so awesome. You know, a few months ago, Natalie's gift language is receiving gifts and also affirmation. So I went out and I just grabbed some flowers that grow wild in the field where we're at, and I came across this one flower that I picked up. There was oranges and blues and purples. I said, I don't have a white. So I picked up this white flower and it stung the heck out of me. Well, that's bull nettle, okay? It looks beautiful, but when you pick it up, it'll sting you. It was isolated. It was standing above everyone else. But when I grabbed it, it's like it hurt me, right? And but that's exactly what happens. When you're in a body and you're in the middle of all the diversified stuff, you might be sitting there, but there's certain people in the body of Christ, they might look pretty, but man, you get close to them, they start stinging. They start messing with you, right? If you look at this other picture, this is the wildflowers. This is what the local body and the local church should look like. It's all different types of backgrounds, all different types of things going on, but it looks absolutely wonderful, right? And I guarantee you, in the middle of all this stuff, there's a bull nettle somewhere around there. But that's okay. When we run into it, we just chop its head off. Or we just, you know, whatever we need to do, we just got to get rid of it. We love it.
Until it becomes a wildflower like this, that's what happens.
Yes, okay. That's what we do. So real quick, so the church, like Natalie mentioned, this church began... in 1991, 92, we were in Bible school. It was 6 o'clock in the morning. I was a part of a prayer meeting, and the Lord put something in my heart as I was praying for people all over the world. The Lord gave me this vision of this dark cloud over a geographical area. Most of you guys have heard this story. And all of a sudden, I heard the Spirit of the Lord say, as you pray, more light will come. And a little beam of light goes through this cloud. I knew it was over an area, but I didn't know what area that was. I just kept praying. I said, more prayer, more prayer, more light. Light started widening up, and all of a sudden, like a pan shot in a movie theater, the Lord showed me that the geographical area that it was over was Seguin, Texas. And it was right there in Central Park. That's why when we began in 2007, the first place, I'm sorry, babe, boom. The first place we began was at Central Park. And so God gave me a burden for that city, for this city. I was born and raised here, but I was gone for the next 20 plus years. But he gave me a burden for this community. And the second thing he gave me a burden for was Haiti. I haven't been to Haiti yet, but I have a feeling God's bringing that up here very, very, very soon. And I'll be a part of that because I know that that's part of my mission. And so here we are. I got that vision. But what I never connected the dots was this, is that until this week, it was that immediately when the Lord gave me that, I didn't think anything of it other than I just pray for my city. But what I see now looking back is that how God immediately began to train us so that years later, we would be back in the city and be actually pastors in this community. And so I didn't know that. I didn't know that back then. So immediately, so in Bible school, you have year one and year two. The first year, it's biblical studies. The second year, it's specific studies. So they have pastoral ministries, evangelistic ministries, teaching ministries, and what have you. And so I said, I'm not a pastor. I'm going to go and be in the helps ministry. And my wife was in the helps ministry. I was like, we're just going to go together and be in the helps ministry together. And so I don't remember this, but what did that lady say whenever we went over there?
When you're in the process of Bible school, and I don't know if y'all know what the helps ministry is, but it's actually in your Bible. And it talks about the ministry gifts. And so helps ministry is everything that is behind the scenes, which I love that. I love the behind the scenes stuff. I love being in the weeds is what people call it. I love that part of it. But anyway, so helps ministry. So Pastor Marcus, when we both went to Bible school, we were 23 and 24 years old. And so he said, we're gonna come to school together. We're gonna be in classes together. We're gonna do everything together. And I was like, yeah, I'm for that. But then God had another plan. And the plan was that he was not to go to helps ministry. He was supposed to go to pastor's class. But he had it in his head that he was not a pastor and he didn't need to go to that class. Well, the lady that was the actual person at the administration that was registering people, he went two times and she rejected his application because she was like, I'm not going to accept this because you're putting the wrong class on there. And he's like, who are you? And so anyway, she was like, you need to be in the pastor's class.
I don't know who this lady is. I'm like, what's wrong with this lady?
And if you know my husband, rejection is not the best thing for his life. And so here this lady's telling him, we're not going to accept this. But all along, even then, God knew that this man would someday need to be back in this community, mm-hmm. pastoring. And so, you know, here's what I was saying to the first service earlier. A lot of times we live our life linear. We think this step and this step and this step. But in God, it's like things can come full circle in your life, and you're wondering why. Because he has always had a plan A. Even though you veer off on your plan B, he will always bring you back to your plan A in life that he has for you, not that you have for yourself. So that day, Pastor Marcus was trying to make a plan B for yourself when God had a plan A.
We left, so they kept my application there. And I'm thinking, hey, they got it. If I don't sign it, they got to put me in the helps class. They can't control me. And so anyways, that's right, right? So I went back to New Braunfels, and I'm sitting there in the back of where the studio's at, where the sound system is, just holding up the wall. And the preacher said, God will not call you to do something that you're able to do. He'll call you to do something that you can't do so that he could get the glory. And immediately I knew that I was supposed to be in the pastor's class. I'm like, Natalie, I got to be in the pastor's class. The Lord just spoke. I'm supposed to be in the pastor's class. But I already signed up and turned in my application. So she's like, I told you. Anyways, we go back to Oklahoma. And I'm walking. I said, the only thing I can do is I can just go talk to admin and let them know that I need to be in the pastor's class. And so, because I already got my acceptance letter. I got my acceptance letter already. And so I'm thinking, I'm in the helps ministry, got my acceptance letter, I'm ready to go. And so I went back over there, I'm walking up to the window of the admin building, and Nancy's there again, whoever this lady
Nancy
is.
Haynes. Mm-hmm.
And I said, Nancy, I said, I believe I'm supposed to be in the pastor's class. And she just smiles. She goes, don't worry about it. We've already been praying for you all summer. I've already committed you in the pastor's class. They already did all the paperwork. And so I didn't have to do anything. So the Lord began to coach me and train me in that field, and that's why we are gifted to do what we are doing. But before it was in my heart, it was in God's heart, is what I'm saying. And before pastoral ministry was, I've implemented and walked in that, the same is true concerning this church. Before it was, we said yes to this vision, it was in the heart of God. And all we happen to be is individuals who would say yes to that craziness, okay? And here we find ourselves. Now, Natalie was going to the Helps ministry, and she said, we didn't have enough money. We were broke, man. We were broke like crazy. And so we just said, hey, if you get, you know, if any money comes in, you go first, and I'll just continue to do what I'm doing at the house.
I told him, I was like, you know, it's more important that you're the leader of our home, you're the spiritual leader of our home, that you finish school. Mm-hmm. I said, I won't go. I'll just hang back, support whatever I can do.
Right.
But during that same period of time that he was arguing with them that he didn't belong in the pastor's class, the lady also told him, she's like, we need your wife's application. We need for her to come in and fill out, because somebody's already paid her tuition in full.
Yeah.
And so I'll tell you something about the Lord. You know, he knows. He knows, because I had told Marcus, I said, you know what? I'm not going to go to school if we don't have the money. I'm not going to apply. And so I didn't apply. I had no intent. But I told the Lord, if you really want me to be in school, you're going to have to make provision, because we couldn't have another year of just eating ramen noodles or whatever you call those, and egg salad sandwiches. I mean, it's good for maybe once a week, but every day for a whole year is kind of gross. But anyway, so I was like, I don't know if I have another year in me to do that. So God had a plan.
Yeah. So whenever I went back and she said, not only are you in the pastor's class, your wife needs to make an application because somebody has come in and paid for all her tuition. And I'm like, well, what about my tuition? Because yours isn't paid for, but hers is. Well, can I use her money for mine? He goes, no, you can't do that. She needs to apply. So it took us another 2 weeks. They would call us again. She needs to apply because this guy keeps coming back to pay cash, and your application's not here. We can't accept this money. Well, who is he? That's none of your business. Just get your application here. So long story short, she put an application, and she got accepted. Now, here's the crazy thing. Natalie goes into the Helps ministry. Natalie has no previous experience in, she didn't even know how to do a typewriter. She didn't do anything. That's just kind of where we were at in life. And out of all the students that were there in that Helps class, she happens to get an instructor by the name of Reggie Knowles. Reggie Knowles was a former FBI agent, DEA. He's the guy that led the way when they were doing like big drug busts. And he began to have a conversation with her, because they had chose her out of her class. They had chose her to become a part of the church secretary's admin office, where they take care of all the pastors. Natalie's not qualified to do any of these. There are other people in that class that have come from large churches. This is what they've done for a living. But her, they chose her because they put it all in prayer, and they said, you're the one that needs to go into the admin office and take care of all the pastors here at this 5,000 member church.
Let me clean this up a little bit. So the only reason that I knew that he was a DEA FBI agent guy was because when they found out that they chose me for that, I thought it was a big, big mistake. Today, I still think it was a big mistake. But anyway, so I went to tell them. I was like, look, I signed up for three things to do. One, I would clean the church. That's what I signed up for. Two, do the grounds. Three, children's ministry. But I cannot do an office with the pastors. I don't know how to type. I don't know how to use a computer. I mean, y'all, prior to that, I helped my husband sell drugs, you know? So I could, you know, I could do a scale. Like, no, that's, you know, you're getting an ounce or 2 ounces, whatever. But I could not type or any of that. Yeah.
Just put some makeup. You know, I was making some money.
I'm putting truth out there because I'm showing you that the power of God does not look at what you were, but he looks at who you are in him.
That's right.
He looks at the deeper gift and the deeper call. He doesn't look at your junk like you try to convince yourself about your junk. And I'm going to just say this right now. Listen, if you're focusing today on what could have, should have, would have, or what you were or what you have done, you're missing out on the very thing that God has called you to this body in the first place. Mm-hmm. He's called you here so that you can be encouraged, so that you can be uplifted. Right. You have two people who were not qualified to do what we're doing. We're only here by the grace of God. And guess what? You're only here by the grace of God too.
That's right.
So maybe you didn't start out the way that you thought that you would, or maybe you're not where you are supposed to be right now, but I'm telling you, it just takes a little course correction. So anyway, this gentleman, I give him my whole story, and then he tells me that he was the one that did the major drug bust here. And he was like, Natalie, we prayed, and you are the one that's supposed to go in there, and you are supposed to be an assistant to the secretary. And I mean, it just scared me. Everything about it scared me. But now I look back, and I see the hand of God who was there, because he knew one day that I would love doing all the behind the scenes things here at Crossroads Church, mm-hmm. and that I would love to see you guys get involved with all the behind the scenes thing. Mm-hmm. And that's why that day that they prayed and he was getting more light would come, that this is all part of his vision. This is not part of our plan. This is not a part of your plan. It's a part of his plan for this body. Amen.
Amen. I love that about, so we could tell you tons of other stories, but here's the point. The point is that it's the heavenly vision that was ordained by Jesus, by the Father, that you're a part of. You have to ask yourself, hey, I'm a part of this vision. What am I doing with my part? You know what's the other crazy thing? And so when the Lord told us to come and start Crossroads, one of the things, you have to go through a nonprofit status and what have you. And one of the questions is if you have to liquidate, if something happens and you have to, you know, fold the church, it closes or whatever, you have to give all the assets to a nonprofit organization. And he was saying, who do you want to give this to? I was like, oh, that's easy, Joel Malm. Well, Joel had no clue that I was even putting his name on there. We knew Joel, but he wasn't a part of our life, you know,
at that moment,
day to day. But I believed in this young man. He used to date my middle daughter, and, you know, until he ran away or whatever he did. And so I love this kid. I love the vision. I love the heart that he had for Jesus. I love the, man, God has just anointed this man. I was like, man, this guy is destined for great things. And and so I believed in him. And so here, little did I know that Joel, Pastor Joel, will become a part of our ministry years later, you know. So he's always, God's always just tied these things together. And I know this brother here, man. I'm telling you, this man is a good man. That's why I have him teaching several times a year. I got him teaching scheduled for 36 times this year. Why? Because I know the gift that God's placed in him, and I know that this body needs to be a recipient of that gift. Amen? So all of 2021, whether you like it or not, he's going to be here, okay? But I've also believed in him so much that, listen, Joel, if the Lord tells you to go wherever you need to go at any time, sisters, I'm all I ask is that let me be a part of that. I want to be a part of what God has in store for your life. If it's here for the rest of your life, fantastic. If it's going somewhere else, fantastic. I just believe in what God's doing in your life. Amen. I want to be a part of that. It's good seed.
Amen.
Amen. And so we're saying all that to say this. So what's in it for you? Why did we share all that in the last 36 minutes? Is because this is a heavenly vision, and you and I have to be a part of this heavenly vision. And you have to ask yourself, okay, what is my part to play? What can I do? How can I do this? You know, the scripture talks about what's in it for you. Man, aren't you tired? I know there's individuals here that are tired of being in a city that's talked about in a negative manner. I know individuals here that are tired of seeing their family and the generation before them go through the same cycle of addiction and habit and prison and, you know, single families over and over again. And then you find yourself in that same place and you don't know how to navigate through that. So you come to church, but you're not really getting involved and getting in and getting cured and getting healed and getting help. So this thing is being passed on to the next generation. Aren't we tired of that? Aren't we tired of living from paycheck to paycheck? Just becoming a church attender is not good enough. We need to be a part of the body to dive in, let the Spirit of God move us, change us, grow us, so that we can instill this truth into the next generation, and this whole city can change.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. Yes. And I love that, because the more light that comes, guess what? Guess what the light is? The light is you. The light is you. You are the light of the world. and you cannot be hidden.
That's right.
And so when you leave from here, you take the light to places that we may never see. Yeah. But you are fulfilling the vision that God called you. He says, as you pray, more light will come. Well, guess what? We pray constantly that God would send light bearers. And guess what? Here you are. And so, amen. Yeah. Amen. Here you are. And so be a light that cannot be hidden. Because it says that as you glow, it's in Matthew 15, I think it is, where mm-hmm. it says, I love this. It says, Matthew, don't hide your light. Let it shine for all to see. Let your good deeds glow, and in that they will praise your heavenly Father. Mm-hmm. Matthew 5:15. So how is God going to be seen? How is more light going to come? It's going to come through you, through your good works, through your deeds. You will glow, and guess what? We will grow, and so will you.
Amen. So what do you do next? Well, in there's a communication card that you should have received. And these are your opportunities for right now in this season that we're in to get involved, to get plugged in, to get involved in the small groups. Now you have to determine, listen, I don't know, the last time I looked, we're in America, okay? So you can make those choices, those adult choices yourself as to whether or not it's safe for you or not. But don't let fear rule you. Well, you and I need to stay connected. One of the things that concerned me, just because I'm a pastor, is not numbers in the seats. It's more that the body of Christ is not meant to be isolated and alone.
Amen.
We need one another. Yes. If you do it through Zoom meetings, fantastic. We just need each other connected. Men need other men that they can pour into and talk and have a barbecue sandwich and talk about what in the world is wrong with our wives or whatever. There's things that we need. We just need to be staying connected because we need each other. And so that's one of the things that frustrates me as a pastor is like, I'm sick and tired of this stuff that people are staying at home when you see them on Facebook, they're all over the place in all these restaurants or concerts, but they're staying away. So all of a sudden the enemy's gotten in and they've gotten weaker and weaker and they're making excuses for not being a part of a local assembly. And I'm telling you, it's going to hurt them in the long run. But guess what? We're still going to be here to restore them, to bring them back, to help them understand that, hey, we're in this together, okay?
Amen.
Every single pastor in this community is facing the same thing. And we're just doing our part to try to help this body, to help you become strong as a family. Amen? That's why we're here. Be the light of the world.
Amen.
So there's a communication card. We really, really encourage you to take the next steps in your life to evaluate those things and then just make a decision. Pray, listen, and obey.
Yeah.
And obey.
And
amen.
Here's the thing about listening, and I said this in the first service. It's so easy to be a hearer of God's word and what God's telling you, but it's a little bit harder to be a doer. And that's where I feel we miss it in life as a Christian. As a Christian, this we miss the doing part because we just read earlier, it says, and they will see your good works.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in order for you to do good works, you need to be doing something. Amen. And it's definitely not going to be sitting as an arm quarterback or whatever you call it, armchair quarterback, talking about, man, I wish things were this way and I wish things were that way. Well, guess what? We don't have to wish. We have a God who is big inside. He's big inside of you. And he's willing to do mighty things. One of the scriptures we've learned all month in Children's Church, Ephesians 6:10, it says that we can do mighty works. He would do mighty works in us. And so through us. And that's what your kids are learning right now in Children's Church. They are like, today they're celebrating being superheroes. And they've seen the superheroes in the Bible all month long. In fact, today they're talking about Gideon in there. And what happened with Gideon? He went with a mighty army. But before he went with the mighty army, he was hiding in a hole.
It's good, bro.
He was hiding in a hole. And some of us out there, you may be hiding in a hole. But I'm telling you that the mighty arm of God wants to pull you out of that hole. He wants to pull you out of that hole. And there is a whole bunch of other brothers and sisters that are here that want to be part of that mighty
Amen.
Army that God has for you.
Preach it, sister.
Amen.
Amen. Now, you have to understand this, okay?
You
have to understand that we have two audiences right here. We have the one that's here live. And by the way, you guys, this body of Christ here, I am so crazy proud of. because all year long, last year, and even already now in 2021, y'all are engaged, y'all are giving, y'all are serving, y'all are doing the best that y'all can with what y'all have. And I love that, how we're doing this together. But there's another congregation that all of a sudden has come and formulated, and it's the congregation online. Some of them, like I said, need to stay home, but some of them need to be provoked a little bit. And so I'm a doctor right now poking at you, those of you who are online, and I'm doing it on purpose because I absolutely love you. And if it's not here, some of the folks will leave and go somewhere else, and that's perfectly fine. But I'm telling you, as a pastor of a community, what's best for us is to stay connected and not isolate ourselves. We are here to be dangerous. We are here to share the gospel of Jesus Christ to a people that do not know God. Amen. There are still 27,000 people in this community that do not go to church. And so I want to do my part as a minister of the gospel to go and find ways to share this message to those who are hopeless. Amen. Amen. And I want you to join me. So thank you guys for those of you who have. Let's all stand. You guys get anything out of that?
Yes.
All right. Good. It's awfully quiet in this Presbyterian church. I love you guys so very much. And I don't know about you, but I hope and pray that Tom Brady wins another one. That's all I can say. All right? All right. Let me finish with that. Father, we love you.
If you are ever in the Seguin area, come visit us on Sunday mornings at 9 or 11 a.m. Or you can just download our app and receive our weekly messages right to your phone. Just text CC Seguin to 77977 and click on the link that you receive. May the remainder of your week be enriched with God's favor and blessings.